Hello everyone, and welcome back to another installment of Red Raptor Writes. Today I'm very excited to once again talk about one of my favorite video games, Fallout 3. Fallout 3 was released way back in 2008 to much critical acclaim and was Bethesda's first entry into the series after purchasing it from Interplay. The third entry is my favorite of the modern Fallouts, and yes, I know this is a controversial opinion. It doesn't have the refined gameplay mechanics of New Vegas or the fun scavenging system of 4. No, but what makes 3 an underappreciated powerhouse within the series is its amazing setting. The Capital Wasteland is one of gaming's shining achievements and a perfect model for the gaming industry, which we'll discover throughout the video. With Fallout 76 in recent memory, Bethesda and its director Todd Howard have quickly become vilified by the gaming community, but back in 2008, the desolate, unpredictable wasteland they crafted was nothing short of fantastic. Us audiences got to see some great world building, unforgettable sense of dread, and tragic visual storytelling. The Capital Wasteland is certainly the star of Fallout 3, as its design is the center of everything else from the main story to the side quests, from the gunplay all the way to turning on the radio. Everything revolves around the post-apocalyptic world we experience, and it all works so well together, creating a sense of depth and immersion that most games can only dream of. So guys, what's so special about Fallout 3? What makes its wasteland so memorable? Let's dig this up. For this analysis, I'm going to kick things off with the story because I think it does a great job at showing the player all of the many terrible problems plaguing the wasteland. Just going through the basic overview is like a rundown of how horrible everything is, which I greatly appreciate. The key to a phenomenal video game is intertwining the story with the gameplay and setting. When the story, gameplay, and setting all advance each other, it provides an epic sense of immersion for the player. Going in order here, we should start with Vault 101. It's an ingenious way to start the game. Players will spend about 30 to 40 minutes here, depending on how thorough they are. This opening is so important because it provides a stark contrast to the Capital Wasteland we'll soon explore. The Lone Wanderer isn't born in the vault, but for his or her entire life, we see a perfectly functioning society. Although the Overseer is strict and eventually goes crazy, for at least 19 years of life, there's steady and stable leadership that you can choose to bump off. Vault 101 is particularly secure with an around-the-clock security task force, unlike many other vaults we see get taken over by creatures and crazies. There are also enough resources in the vault to last for years, so much so that the vault dwellers are able to have full-scale birthday parties for each of its inhabitants without any problem. That means a lot of food, but most importantly, water. Water is the central goal or idea behind Fallout 3. Taking a concept from the original Fallouts and building it further.
It was your mother's favorite passage. It's from the Bible. Revelation 21:6. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely.
Why can't Liam Neeson do a voice recording of the whole Bible? Do you know how often I'd listen to that? Sunday school would get 10 times more awesome. So, right from the moment our character crawls, we're introduced to the idea of clean water, a crucial resource that's given no second thought in Vault 101, but immediately upon our exit, becomes a very scarce commodity. In the wasteland, most of the water is highly irradiated. Unless you've taken the lead belly perk early on, you'll find that drinking from any sink pumps your body with unwanted rads, and drinking straight from the Potomac or any other water source, forget it. It's made clear to the player early on that water is radiation central. This is why the main goal of the Lone Wanderer's quest is to complete their father's creation, Project Purity, a giant water purifier within the Jefferson Memorial that will clean all the water in the capital region. Another good hint of water's importance is how the Lone Wanderer will stumble across a thirsty hobo outside of the first settlement they'll come across, Megaton, who suffers from radiation poisoning and begs for clean water. The problem of irradiated water is deeply established very early on in Fallout 3, Unlike, say, New Vegas, where purified water is very common. Even when drinking straight from rivers and lakes, the water is perfectly fine. Oh, I should mention now, I'm going to be making a lot of comparisons to New Vegas and Fallout 4. Unless I specifically state otherwise, these comparisons aren't meant to be put-downs. New Vegas is great, but just takes a different approach to its world for the benefit of its own narrative. And Fallout 4 is good, in my opinion. Some things it does very well, some things it does not so well. Speech. But anyways, I hope this brings more of an appreciation for the opening of Fallout 3. I've heard of some people not enjoying Vault 101 or complaining that the game takes its time to build up, but that segment is crucial to A, tutorialize the player on the game's RPG and shooter mechanics, yes, but just as importantly, B, establish the central conflict of the story by contrasting how easy some vault dwellers have it compared to the suffering outside world that needs the player and James's help. If you're looking for an instant action, balls-to-the-wall shooter, then don't play a story-driven RPG. Stick to Fortnite, I hear that's where all the 10-year-olds go. Okay, moving on to Megaton. The opening settlement is a staple in Fallout games. The original Fallout had Shady Sands, the second had Arroyo, 3 has Megaton, and New Vegas with Good Springs. The starting town became a useful trope in the series because it was a good way to quickly get the player invested in the world around them. They helped establish the world as a whole, were a good kicking off point in the story as they pointed the player in the right direction, and they gave some early side quests that further got the player acquainted with the world and game mechanics. It's a shame Fallout 4 skipped out on this by leaving Sanctuary a blank slate of a town to practice your building skills on, rather than an established settlement already. The player will likely not learn about Sin's taking over until they reach the first major remnant of civilization, Diamond City, several hours in. Thankfully, Fallout 3 doesn't do this and sticks with the tried and true formula, because Megaton is a key piece in establishing this post-apocalyptic nightmare. Of course, there we meet Moira, who gives the quest Wasteland Survival Guide. Ah, Moira, she's wonderful.
Try not to die!
This is an excellent quest because it gets early players to explore various locations to understand the terrors of the Waste and how to conquer them. As a good example, players are sent to Minefield, which looks like a total war zone as it's absolutely covered in frag mines and has a sniper trying to blow your head off. Heading to the Anchorage War Memorial gets you acquainted with some of the monsters that roam around. Or what about the Super Duper Mart, where we find that food and medicine are being hoarded by vicious raiders who've settled in. Overall, the Wasteland Survival Guide is a great quest, and I appreciate how it pushes the players to see the horrors of the world up close. Ned would be so proud. Also in Megaton is a little side quest to fix 3 leaky pipes. Once that's done, the maintenance man Nathan will pay the player to deliver him scrap metal to keep repairs going. Not only is this a good money-making scheme, since scrap is literally everywhere, but this helps show the player that everything in the Capital Wasteland is in a state of disrepair. All the structures are very crude, mostly made from metal sheets or whatever's left of Washington DC. Everything is either destroyed or rusted over, so constant repairs are needed to maintain a somewhat suitable home for settlers. Then of course, how can we talk about Megaton without addressing the elephant in the room, or more accurately, the atomic bomb in the ground? The first settlement we come across is built around a bomb that's ready to blow everyone up. A clear reminder of the past that left the survivors of 2277 with a ruined, radioactive world sits right in the middle of town. Constantly we walk by the symbol of man's destructive nature that still plagues the United States because...
But war... War never changes.
Yes, thank you, Von Perlman. War and humanity's propensity towards violence never change, as most Wastelanders still run around killing each other, as the player has probably seen in Springvale and soon will see in the Super Duper Mart. The player can even launch nuclear weapons that still haunt the capital region. Dang, it's crazy how much world building occurs out of just one town. That's good storytelling. Once the player decides to continue the main quest, they'll meet Moriarty, who points the player towards GNR, forcing us to traverse the subways where we'll face ghouls and super mutants for likely the first time. Again, the story pushes us through all these abominations of 2277 to show just how decrepit the world has become. There are little zombies running around attacking people, and people started taking Shrek cosplaying a little too seriously. I'll talk more about these tunnels later on, but for now, we're introduced to more super mutants, the Brotherhood of Steel, and the remnants of DC proper. From here on out, the Lone Wanderer has seen pretty much everything and is fully acquainted with the world, but we're not done yet because slavers. To my mind, Fallout 3 is the only Bethesda-era Fallout game to prominently feature slavery. In Fallout 4, Kate reveals how she was a former slave, but most of society doesn't seem to care about slavery. Maybe it is around, but nobody cares, or it doesn't get mentioned because it's not really an issue. We just don't come across many slaves of any in the Commonwealth. New Vegas is the same way. Please feel free to correct me in the comments, but the Mojave doesn't seem to have a slavery problem. Okay, that sounds really stupid at face value. Caesar's Legion is a terrifying slave society trying to take over the Mojave. The entire base of their army is slaves, and women are captured to be forced into lives of constant reproduction. Okay, I get it. But enslavement isn't a general fear in the New Vegas area. Unless the Legion wins the war, nobody seems to be losing sleep over it. It's more of an external force coming in, rather than a natural part of the world, if that makes any sense. Slavers are trying to invade and establish themselves, but slavery isn't a fundamental establishment in Nevada. I hope this makes sense, okay? Fallout 3 is on a completely different level, though. Society has become so crippled and depraved that bands of slavers roam around DC, putting slave collars on their victims, forcing them into lives of servitude. There's nothing to stop anyone from being captured. We see this throughout our adventure, how it's such a dark yet common part of the world. In terms of the main story, the second act requires the player to find a Garden of Eden creation kit, or GEC, to finish Project Purity. Again, everything goes back to that idea of water. It's the motivation for the main characters.
We need water. Water.
Shut up, bitch!
In order to acquire the GEC located in Vault 87, the Lone Wanderer has to go through caves in the child-run town Little Lamplight, but the mayor needs you to rescue some children from slavery before letting you in. Guys, I don't know if the Wasteland has desensitized us or not, but small children are being forced into slavery. If the player is going for an evil run, they can even side with the slavers and capture one of the dumber kids. Also, if you want, there's a side quest, Head of State, where you decide who runs the Lincoln Memorial. Slavers trying to erase the memory of emancipation in order to give their oppressive way of life more of a foothold, or Hannibal Hamlin's gang of runaways who want to give hope and a safe refuge. Yeah, this might fit more into the gameplay section of this, but I may as well mention it here. You can roleplay as a slaver in Fallout 3, very much unlike Fallout 4, where morality was gutted as a system. You can be the one doing the enslaving. You can be the one putting collars on people's necks and making caps from it. Dang, this game is brutal. Well, it looks like I'm getting into Fallout 3's gameplay anyways, so cue to transition. Fallout 3 has very noticeable gameplay differences when compared to the other modern installments. Now, that seems like a big bruh moment, considering that gameplay always evolves and hopefully improves over the course of a series. But in this case, the difference makes 3 feel like a much more desperate, oppressive game than New Vegas and 4. Actually, it's quite impressive how different each of the 3 games feel, as the gameplay serves the tone each of them is trying to accomplish. New Vegas is centered around conflicts between large-scale factions, established countries. Because the Mojave is in a much more stable position, it feels much safer, much more connected, and more civilized. Yes, there are some difficult shootouts here and there, but overall, New Vegas is more post-apocalyptic, making for a much more chill experience. Fallout 4 is about rebuilding society in the image that the player chooses, so it makes sense that the best part is looting the waste for resources to build functioning settlements, and why so many missions are about killing the leftover enemies that threaten civilization. Not that every change is good, but the gameplay in these games is specifically tailored to how the world and the player are supposed to interact. That brings us to Fallout 3, which is no different in this regard. Of the modern Fallout entries, 3 is easily the most ruined and decrepit and uncivilized.
So uncivilized.
In many cases, it even crosses over into horror as the dark, hopeless environments oppress the player. Anyone who's entered the Dunwich building in the southwest corner of the map knows what I'm talking about. I know navigating subway lines is no one's favorite part of the game, but it provides a great sense of dread knowing that feral ghouls could be around any corner waiting to rush you down. Fallout 3 does a great job of putting the player in the shoes of a survivor who struggles to make it in the capital wasteland, the same experience everyone else around you is having. This area is extremely hostile, so many different creatures and factions want to rip your face off. Actually, it's more of an exception to find someone or something that doesn't want to kill you. Let's see, there are cute Brahmin that occasionally roam around, trade caravans, Brotherhood Knights, Brotherhood Outcasts, and maybe the random scavenger or two. Not a huge list. Now, think of everything that wants to slaughter you. Rad roaches, mole rats, feral ghouls, mad Brahmin, vicious dogs, mire lurks, giant ants, rad scorpions, yaogai, deathclaws, raiders, talon company mercs, super mutants, centaurs, regulators, protectrons, Mr. Gusties, sentry bots, and even cannibals when they're in the mood. Yeah, it's super dangerous, making players think twice about stepping outside into the cruel world. This feeds back into the story, as we encounter the disgusting results of human experimentation and the effects of war, especially in the wildlife. It impacts the setting by giving us a massive taste of the devastation. The chaotic nature of the post-war world, where everything is left killing everything else because...
War never changes.
Yes, again, thank you, Ron. What's left of the US is so chaotic and brutal that it's stuck in a constant state of battle. This is another area where Fallout 3 feels so much crazier than the other games. In New Vegas, you will know exactly where to find each enemy. Scorpions always spawn by the Brotherhood outpost, ants spawn in open flats by the side of the road, swamp lurks are regulated pretty much to the eastern side of the map by the Colorado River and Lake Mead. Deathclaws are isolated in Quarry Junction and rarely anywhere else, etc, etc. Everything is organized to represent the more organized structure of the West. Things are much more stable. In 3, on the other hand, anything can interact with anything. Random events feel truly random because there's no limit to what can happen in the world. Anything can interact with anything else. Well, okay, there are a few limits, like how difficult enemies won't spawn outside of a settlement so as to not kill everyone, but for the most part, yeah, utter chaos. Death is everywhere. Also dangerous is not just the enemies in the post-nuclear war world, but all the radiation those bombs left, a constant reminder of how much the world is ruined by nuclear war. Now, I have to credit Fallout 4 here, although I feel like I've been bashing it this entire time. I swear I like it, guys, don't worry. What's probably the most iconic element is the glowing sea in the southwest corner of the map. That place is so irradiated to the point that it's covered in glowing ash or dust and is in a perpetual state of rad storms. The enemies feel larger and more terrifying, with any resemblances of safety being few and far between. That was amazing. Plus, I gotta give props to the inclusion of rad storms. The world over 200 years after those bombs dropped is still plagued by the occasional storm that blankets the world in radiation, reminding people how terrible everything still is because the stupid leaders of 2077 couldn't keep it together. A frequent sound you'll hear in this installment is the clicking of your Geiger counter, because this stuff is just everywhere. It's in the food, in the water, and blankets many locations. Not only does it hurt the player, but as we've seen, others suffer because they're so sick with rads. Major settlements have to deal with it by building their own water purifiers, just so the entire towns don't die themselves to death. At the same time though, the Capital Wasteland is a very quiet place. The player will have many moments of emptiness. It's so chilling. I may dare say that Fallout 3 is at its best when the player is wandering the map, surveying the devastation, no hints of life, gusts of wind blowing, and the music swells up. It's so tragic, yet strangely beautiful at the same time. Bethesda does everything to immerse us into their post-apocalyptic world. Okay, so let's talk about more gameplay elements. Let's talk about guns. The way you play with your guns is far different than New Vegas and 4. Starting with weapon condition. In Fallout 3, weapons break far faster than in New Vegas. In the former, you are constantly eyeing that shotgun's health bar. I find myself carrying multiple shotguns, multiple hunting rifles, just so I can make repairs on the fly. Prolonged use quickly destroys your favorite guns. In the latter though, gun condition can sit quietly in the back of your mind. It's a problem, but not nearly as big of a problem. Again, this shows the difference in the organized and stable society of the Mojave with the rundown tragedy of DC. Then there's Fallout 4, in which weapon and armor condition just doesn't exist. Maybe Bethesda felt that having guns deteriorate would have undermined their crafting system. Maybe they didn't want the player to feel like they were wasting precious resources on repairing, who knows. We should also discuss the way damage is calculated. Once again, for the sake of comparison, let's bring up New Vegas. The 2010 release functions on a system primarily of damage threshold like the originals. Whatever armor or clothing the player's wearing gives DT. Whatever the number of DT the player is wearing from their various clothes gets subtracted from whatever instance of damage they take. Say a player has a threshold of 10 and take a hit of 20 damage. That 10 gets subtracted, thus cutting the 20 damage in half. That's basically how it works. Fallout 3, on the other hand, has a much less forgiving damage resistance. DR is calculated as a percentage. Let's take the same scenario, except with resistance instead of threshold. 10 resistance means that an attack of 20 damage will lose 10%, thus losing 2 points, leaving you with a final hit of 18. That's far more painful than in New Vegas. To keep things a bit more balanced, Fallout 3 armor gives a greater amount of DR than New Vegas armor gives DT, so the difference isn't as extreme, but still notable. Now, something equally important, ammo. Ammo is everything in this game. You may find the best guns early on, but good luck keeping them loaded. The player will find themselves losing bullets faster than Nick Cage losing his mind. Pretty early on, the player will even find the fat man outside of GNR. No, that fat man. The game has no problem handing this over, but have fun finding mini nukes. When approaching Fallout 3, it's important to remember that while it contains plenty of shooting, it's not primarily a shooter. It's an RPG, so it's not for the player to run around guns blazing. No, the player has to conserve and work to survive. Resources are scarce, so every shot needs to be calculated. Again, it's hard out there. The world isn't throwing fresh guns and ammo at you. You have to survive, scavenge, make the most with what you have. Fallout 3 is great at putting us players into that mindset by making the gameplay brutal and oppressive. That's what games should do. Not just tell us information like the wasteland is bad, but by letting the player experience for themselves. It's like the video game version of the classic line, show don't tell. For games, it's more play, don't show or tell. Okay, so one last point here, I have to praise the addition of the radio. I haven't seen a lot of praise given to Fallout 3 for this, which is strange considering how it was the first in the series to include a licensed soundtrack. We've seen the Atomic Age 1950s influences on the first two installments way back in the 90s, so I find it great how not only was their style imported, but their music too. Is it 100% sensical that only vintage music survived and not Nirvana or
Justin Bieber?
No, not really, but it helps sell the Atomic vibe so well. Plus, how can I bring up Galaxy News Radio without crediting its awesome host, 3Dog? 3Dog is excellent. He brings that radio charisma, probably because of his hat, while also being the only true voice of reason in the wasteland. This dude will give advice on survival by warning audiences against raiders, ghouls, weapon condition, and radiation. Again, so many details are used to push this horrific apocalypse vibe. No matter how you feel about the game, you must admit, the dedication is astounding. I know most of my comparisons have been more on the relative side, like what New Vegas does is tailored to that experience and what 3 does is to its experience. In this instance though, no, 3 Dog is the best hands down. Mr. New Vegas doesn't have the fully exaggerated swagger of a black teen. And Travis's paralyzingly awkward joke gets real old real fast, followed by his super overconfident joke that gets real old real fast. Alright, that got a little tangential, but you guys are smart, you get the point. I'd be joking if I said Fallout 3 had the smoothest gameplay, but so many of its elements are implemented to further the world building, and it works so well. Now, onto the world design. This seems like an obvious one. Of course, a game set in a dreary, post-apocalyptic future looks, you won't believe this, dreary and post-apocalyptic. Yes, but there's also a bunch of little details in how the world is designed that totally sell the experience. There's all the big, obvious choices I can get to, like dead trees and dust decorating DC. But again, you folks at home are smart, so I'll only point out the little things. Let's start out with settlement design. But to make my first point, I'll show you a series of clips so you can see for yourself a common theme.
For the last time, no zombies allowed.
Can't you tell the difference between me and a feral? Fine, I'll show you the goddamn difference. Just you wait. You'll get yours, all of you.
Look, you see how every major settlement is heavily guarded? All of them either have some intercom system to verify a traveler's identity, or some kind of hired gun guarding the front. Usually this results in the lone wanderer being questioned immediately upon arrival to make sure they're not scum.
You will never find the more wretched hive of scum and villainy.
You can't just walk in and out of every town. They all have walls or makeshift fences. Wow, big town had a wall, but the US is stuck with this? I'm not going to blow anyone's minds here when I say that walls are great for defense because they provide cover to the defenders and they prevent enemies from just running into the city or wherever. Barriers are also common in the Capital Wasteland because danger is so common. Again, raiders, super mutants, slavers, deathclaws, all the things you don't want coming into your town. If the world actually did turn into a pile of ash, heck yeah, you expect settlements to build walls and hire security guards. Fallout 4 does much of the same with its notable Diamond City, but again, look at how New Vegas handles this. They're not worried about the very rare super mutant or bands of raiders, although maybe they should be with the prison riot and Legion invasion. Now, there are a lot of walls and guards in New Vegas, but there are also some towns that are just an open free-for-all. Doesn't matter who you are, you can just walk in and out. And Novak has an unlocked gate. Yeah, good thinking, guys. That'll stop Caesar. Okay, I'm definitely getting ahead of myself. Having walls and security don't just help protect against a common raider, but it's clear that settlers are trying to make do with what's left from the old world, make the most out of a bad situation. Towns are placed in very odd locations because they provide some strategic advantage. Rivet City is on a broken aircraft carrier, Arafu is on a highway, Little Lamplight is in a cave, and so on. This tells us that people were thinking logically when finding a home, interacting with the world in their own way, which adds a nice sense of consistency and believability. On a more shallow note, having strange locations with a guarded entrance also makes every arrival all the more interesting. Walking into a new town is an event for the player to remember. The Rivet City Bridge is a visual that sticks with us after we turn off the game. These small moments may seem inconsequential at first glance, but the theatrics stick with us while further fleshing out the world. Bethesda adds a lot to their locations in order to make them feel more believable, creating a sense of internal consistency. Walls are one thing, but I encourage you to have a look around some of these places. The towns sprinkled throughout the Capital Wasteland have facilities in place to meet the basic needs of their citizens. A quick look around and you'll find bathrooms, beds, restaurants, bars, a doctor, and generators. While there are some unnamed PCs just walking around, named characters all have jobs to support themselves. Others are traders who roam the map selling to different towns. And notice how each trader has a Brahmin to carry their stuff and a hired mercenary because it's dangerous out there. Even the raiders have places where they sleep, sources of food, water, and medicine. Nothing exists in a void. Everything is connected and has a place in the world. Something else I love are all the little strategically placed props that tell a story. This is something that all of these Fallouts have in a Shrekload. Isolated locations that use visual storytelling to help with world building. Let's start with the kids in cages, though this isn't the US border, but Springvale Elementary School. Now, we don't know much about what happened to the school. There are a few stories with raiders who squat there, but with the children who attended, we don't really know. However, we're given what looks like a clue with a large cage stuffed with small skeletons. Were children held as hostages? Were they tortured? Cannibalized? It's unclear, but something definitely happened here. Also, another good example is this random guy on a pier in the middle of the map. He's surrounded by beers and snacks, like he knew the world was going up in flames, but he decided to watch as the sun set on the old world. Honestly, I can see this happening. It sounds kinda nice to just come to peace with death and enjoy the show. Again, with only a few well-placed props, Bethesda was able to convey many different emotions all at once. Vault 87, the birthplace of Washington Super Mutants, also uses visual storytelling to show the strange experimentation that went on there as scientists tested the FEV. The Lone Wanderer can even discover that there's none left here, which is why the mutants are so preoccupied with traversing the wasteland and breaking into vaults. Because they're sterile, they need to find more FEV in order to create more of their kind. If not, then they become extinct. Man, the amount of work that must have gone into adding all these details has to be appreciated. It's the small things that really bring this setting to life. I've been doing a lot of complimenting in this video because, well, Fallout 3 has a lot to praise, but I would be misleading my audience if I pretended that everything was perfect. No game is perfect. Okay, almost no game is perfect. Yeah, so remember when I said I'd get back to the tunnel system? Well, now is that time. Honestly, I don't dislike them. In fact, a lot of the game's most intense and creepiest moments happen here. Like the rest of the world, the subway tunnels are in complete ruin, they're dark, usually ghoul-infested, and are another great example of how screwed up and awful the wasteland is. Great. Unfortunately, they're just a little too annoying to navigate. You see, the DC ruins are blocked off into different sections, and the only way to reach these sections is via subway tunnel. So in order to explore everything the wasteland has to offer, the player needs to become an expert on the DC transit system. Plus, they're all very samey, hard to tell apart, and there aren't enough signs to easily navigate. A separate subway map in the Pip-Boy could have cleared this up easily. Another nitpick I have is the ecosystem, as in, how the heck does it function? When everything is trying to murder everything else, well, everything murders everything else. And when there's nothing left to murder, the surviving creatures will go starving. Outside of Oasis, there are no living plants. Without plants, there's nothing to produce energy and serve as a base for the entire ecosystem. Fallout 4 fixed this up by adding vegetation to feed the herbivores, and herbivores to feed the carnivores instead of just carnivores. That works much better than every creature participating in a battle royale. I like what they did by making a super dangerous and violent wasteland, but I don't see why we can't have the best of both worlds. Yes, it's a nitpick, but it takes away from the setting's internal consistency. Okay, final thing. I also mentioned how the third installment doesn't have the smoothest gameplay. It's not something I mind, but I know others who do. I like it because the shooting is purposefully wonky. As an RPG, not just an FPS, How good your character is with guns directly ties into their skill with the type of said gun. If your lone wanderer has a low small gun skill, then they'll be less accurate and their scopes will sway more. The same goes with the other weapon types. If your build sucks at using energy weapons, then expect stormtrooper aim with laser rifles. Plus, having clunky guns kind of further cements the fact that everything you're using is over 200 years old and survived a nuclear apocalypse. Yeah, don't expect everything to be in factory condition. Okay, that's enough complaining for now. Let's wrap up the analysis. Different Fallout games do different things amazingly. Instead of doing a full-on giant retrospective, I wanted to highlight the specific thing that Fallout 3 does amazingly. What makes Fallout 3 so great wasn't just the exciting quests or voice talents of Liam Neeson, but the amount of depth Bethesda was able to give its world. Like every game should strive for, the story, gameplay, and setting all flow into each other seamlessly. This creates an unbreakable level of immersion. I played Fallout 3 probably 10 years ago as just a youngling, and what stuck with me the most was the brutal, cynical setting of 2277 Washington DC. Everything from the hobos to gun condition to prop placement to even the hecking radio all feed into this beast of a setting, working to create a world as believable as our own. Although there is a lot of lore in the series, it's not needed to make an engaging setting. This game proved that, really, all you need is a sense of coherence, harmony between the different parts of the game to engage the audience. While Fallout 3 does have its share of flaws, what the now vilified Todd Howard and friends were able to create back in 2008 was nothing short of fantastic. Remember, if you enjoyed this video, to please leave a like, subscribe, and check out my social media. See you next time.